It's good to be together this morning, and man, good to gather, and good to, we're going to celebrate some baptisms today, which is always a great experience, and so we're looking forward to that. But you know, before we dive into our teaching this morning, I think it would be important for us to just spend a few moments reflecting on kind of what's happening in our world. You know, over the last week, there's been several activities. You know, and we're talking about Paris, we're talking about Beirut, we're talking about situations on our globe where tragedy has taken place. And you know, as we, you know, being folks that like look at God's words for direction and seek His face, you know, we have an understanding that we live in a fallen world, that folks are lost, that we ourselves, we stumble and we fall, and there's all sorts of fallenness and depravity, and sometimes even evil choices that are made that cause destruction and harm. So as we think about this, there's one major word that I want you to hear, and then I want us to go to prayer about a couple prayer requests. But here's the major word I want you to hear. Whatever has happened this week in our world, it has not knocked God off the throne. I mean, God is still God, and He is. This is still His world. He's still in control. He's still offering grace and mercy and love, and so we need to embrace that fact. It's good when we gather together and we worship, because it reminds us of that. That when we worship, it reminds us that our Heavenly Father is above, and he knows, and he cares, and so that matters to us. And then in three prayer requests that we should express. First of all, today we should pray for the families that have suffered some great loss over this past week. We should pray for them and just lift them up. Then we should pray for leadership all over the globe, that they would be wise in their decisions and in their responses to what should take place to provide, you know, peace and safety. And then as people of God, we should pray for the gospel to be effective and powerful. And here's what the gospel tells us. Jesus Christ died on the cross for all of our wrongdoing, everybody's wrongdoing. And the answer to the issues and the problems in our world is truly Christ. And so we should pray that the gospel would be powerful, effective, not only to our neighbor, to the person who sits across the desk from us, but from people all over the world who even think with way different mindsets than perhaps we think. We should pray that the gospel is powerful and effective in those minds and hearts. Let's pray together. Jesus, I thank You for Your presence in this place. I thank You for the reality that when the world gets rocked by fallenness and by sin or by evil choices, Lord, and the world gets rocked, and we can look and say, this is unfair, this is hostile, this is, Lord, I just pray that the reality of who You are would well up within our soul. That we would be so steadfast and so ironed will on the fact that You are who You are, and we celebrate that You are God and there is no other, that You're our hope and You're our salvation, that the Word says that You are our strong tower and the righteous run into You. The Word says You are our shield. So, Lord, in all times, you know, don't let our hearts be dominated by fear. Don't let our hearts be dominated by hopelessness. But let our hearts be filled with Your courage and with Your peace. And Lord, we want to lift up the families that have suffered and lost this past week. And Lord, we just pray for them that Your Spirit would work in their hearts and their minds and somehow bridge the gap that now exists there. And Jesus, we pray for our leaders. That as they think about this huge responsibility they have, leaders all over the world, Lord, I pray that You would help them to think about peace and safety and security and how all that happens. Let Your wisdom shine through. And then, Jesus, I pray that Your gospel would be powerful and effective in us and through us. Lord, to the person across the street, to the person around the globe. Lord, work in powerful and awesome ways. You are the answer that the world is looking for. Help us, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We praise you. And in this moment, help us focus on our message, Lord. Help our minds get geared around what it means in a complex world to have this powerful and simple invitation to follow you. We love you, Jesus. In your name, amen. Would you understand what I mean if I would say I'm a bullet point person? Would you understand what I mean if I would say that? Because I'm a bullet point person, which means that I like communication to come to me in like very simple forms. In fact, if you've ever emailed me an email and it's been long and there's been hefty paragraphs to that and it's been extended, you may ask me later, hey, Pastor, did you read my email? And I would say, I tried. I really tried. But I don't know if it's my attention issues or what it is. I really need bullet point form. That would help me so much. And it's not that I don't believe in personal investment. Of course I believe in that. Or I believe in personal commitment. Absolutely I believe in that. It's just that sometimes complexity is so hard when you desire like maybe something that's a little more simple and clear. But you know, you may agree with me or not agree with me on this, that it seems like the world we live in becomes increasingly more complex. And it almost seems like we're built that way. It's like we're built to take simple things and make them complex rather than complex things and make them simple. Like for instance, and in a lighthearted way, I think this is a prime example of what we're up against, right? In a lighthearted way. Like take for instance, video games, right? So how many of you here would say, hey, I'm a gamer. I like to play video games. How many of you would say that? Okay, most of you under 20. Okay. So let me ask you this. How many of you remember or you ever owned the Atari system? Raise your hand. Oh yeah, a lot more gamers out there than first admitted, huh? Yeah. Well, you know, when I was 16 years old, I bought an Atari system. And it was the first, like, gaming system you could hook up to your television. And I remember the very first game I had. It was like the Pong game, right? And I was incredible at it. It was amazing. You had three little digital dots, and they slid on each side of the screen, and one dot that kind of went everywhere. And your job was just to keep that dot bouncing and not let it get by you. And I was really good at Pong. But it was a very simple game. It was a simple game. And then I remember when I bought Pac-Man for the same system. You know, Pac-Man and Pac-Man, it's a little more complex than Pong, right? But it's still fairly simple. You eat the pellets and you stay away from the ghost and you do okay. And in fact, how many of you remember the first controller? Here was the first controller to my Atari system, right? Think about that. Man, it's a piece of art. Simplicity, right? I mean, there's one directional control and one button. Two hands, two things to do. It's incredible. It's genius. Well, I graduated off my Atari system as I became older, and ultimately we ended up owning a Sega Genesis, right? And have you seen the controller for Sega Genesis? Now again, for most of you, you're like, Sega Genesis, man, that was back in the Stone Age. But I mean, look at the complexity of this controller. The other one had one directional control and one button. This one has one directional pad, right? And seven buttons. I mean, that's exponentially making this whole thing more complex, isn't it? But then, you know, my boys got older and they liked this whole gaming thing and they liked to play the video games. And so we ended up like buying an Xbox and a PlayStation. And here's the Xbox controller. Now here's what I want you to know. There are buttons on this thing that I played for years and didn't know there were buttons hidden on this thing. Here's the truth. There are three directional controls and 13 buttons. I mean, it's incredible. Man, my guys would get this, and right, and they're young. They're 9, 10, 11 years old, and they would get this controller. And I mean, man, their fingers are moving, and their thumbs are going, and they're doing this. And they'd be like, Dad, play with me, and come down here and play. So I'd come down there and play, and we'd be playing a game. And I mean, man, they would be killing me, literally and figuratively, in this game over and over again. And they had this first person thing going on where no longer did you see the figure, but like you were the figure. And I could never figure that out. I could never get to where it is I needed to go. And they figure out where I reappeared after they did me in. And they would run back to where I reappeared. And they'd do me in again over and over and over again. And I'm like, this is just too complicated. And so I had to turn the controller over to the experts who were 9 and 10 and 11. I mean, that doesn't seem right, does it? But they were like experts, and I didn't. But, you know, like exponentially complex. And then I don't, have you joined a health club lately? I mean, have you joined a health club? You know, now I'm going to give you a little bit of a tidbit of information that hopefully everybody here is going to be incredibly impressed about, right? I want you to go home. I want you to put it as your Facebook status. So when I was a freshman in high school, okay, this would have been back in 1979/80, right? I was on the weightlifting team, and we would go to competitions. And so when I was a freshman, 14 years old, I won the weightlifting championship for the freshmen in the state of Ohio. I won the state competition in the state meet. Oh, yeah. No. But I won the competition, right? And it was really easy. I mean, I would go to the weight room after school, and there would be several of us that are on the team, played football, and we lifted weights. And so I'd go to the weight room, and there was maybe two different types of bars in the weight room. And then there were these big metal discs. And what you do is you take these big metal discs and you slip them on the bars, and then you just start moving them around in all sorts of different ways, right? You'd bench and you'd deadlift and you'd squat and you'd do all these activities, and you would sweat like crazy, and it was really easy. Join a health club today. I mean, you walk in and there's 50 different machines. And it's like every machine can do two or three different things. And literally you have to have an expert show you how to sweat. It used to be you just went in the room, you just pumped some iron, you could sweat, and you didn't need a whole lot of instruction. But now you go to the health club, and there has to be some expert to tell you how to use the machine so you can sweat correctly. And then we have to buy all these little bands that we put on our wrists that tell us you better start moving, you're about to die. We never used to like need all that stuff. I mean, you know, we have to schedule times to like work out. And the complexity is everywhere. Like, get this, and I'm not trying to make a political statement, so forgive me for this. This really is not a political statement, but let's just talk about taxes for a second. So when the whole thing started for us as a nation, there was a really, like, they had, like, a really simple rule about taxes. Do you remember what it was? No taxation without representation, right? Very simple thought. No taxation without representation. So, you know, there weren't a whole lot of taxes. In fact, the first sales tax came into effect right after the War of 1812. So they put in the sales tax after the War of 1812. They kept the sales tax in place 3 years while they paid for what they needed to after the War of 1812. And then in an amazing, miraculous thing, you know what they did? They ended that tax. They just stopped it, right? 3 years, they paid for what they needed to pay for, and it ended. It wasn't until 1913 that we had the first permanent tax. And that took place in the 16th Amendment, right? You're probably familiar with this, just a little bit of history. So in 1913, the first permanent tax comes into place with the 16th Amendment, and it was the first year that a 1040 form was filled out. Was anybody here fill that form out? Nobody did. Well, we've been filling them out ever since, right? But when they made the tax code, this sounds like massive, right? But when they made the tax code in 1913 was 400 pages, which that seems like a lot, doesn't it? I mean, they implemented the first tax ever. There's 400 pages. I mean, here's a book. Bam, two, there's the tax code, 400 pages. That's a lot. Seems like a lot. Anybody want to guess how many pages of tax code we have now? 74,600 plus. I mean, here's the reality. You cannot fill your taxes out anymore. You need an expert. You either have to get a software program that helps you to do it, or you have to hire an expert, because there's 74,600 pages. There's no way for you to keep up with that tax code. And then yet in the mix of all of this complexity that surrounds us, There's a very simple invitation that I want to give you this morning. Just a very simple invitation. It comes from Matthew 4:19. And the invitation is this. Come, follow me. Jesus said that over and over again throughout the scriptures as he called his disciples. He would just simply look at them and he would say, hey, I want you to come, follow me. Well, what does that mean? Well, I want you to go where I'm going to go. I want you to do what I'm going to do. And I want you to say what I'm going to say. I want you to receive the forgiveness that I'm offering you. And I want you to journey with me through life, going and doing and saying and being like me. Just follow me. And you know, this invitation, I don't make it by my own authority. I'm really offering you this idea of following Jesus based on his authority and what he's done. But you know, so many times when I make this invitation, I get a common response back from folks. And one of the common responses that I receive is this. Say, hey, you know, we just need to follow Jesus. And here's what I'll often hear. I can't because I don't know the rules. I mean, I don't know all the rules that there are with this whole thing to follow Jesus. And in a strange way, I get that. I get that probably because most of us have heard more about the rules than we've heard about Jesus. I mean, most of us have heard more about the do's and the don'ts than we've heard about the Savior himself. There are over 1,700 different branches of Jesus' followers. And every one has a little different vent or a little different twist or a little different emphasis in this whole big thing, but 1,700 different. And a very common question for me in the role that I play is when somebody visits, somebody will say, hey, tell me the difference between you and one of the 1,699 different ones. And I'm like, ooh, wow. And I get the question, right? Because we're all just trying to figure this thing out. There's 1,700 different. And I think about, wow, what's happened to us? Because, you know, like when Israel left Egypt, they cross the Red Sea, they get to Mount Sinai. Moses goes up Mount Sinai to cut the first covenant with God, right, between God and his people. And basically, he comes down off the mountain with 10 big ones, right? 10 commandments, 10 big ones. And there are some other things attached there, like how they were going to run the government and some dietary regulations because they had to be careful what they ate and, you know, what was healthy and what wasn't healthy. But ultimately, he came down with 10 big ones. Hey, man, here's it. Here's the 10 commandments. Bam, here they are. And then, you know, from the time of Moses till the time that Jesus showed up, they took that which Moses delivered from Mount Sinai, they chopped it up, they expanded it, and they sub-pointed it, and they came up with 613 different rules. 248 positive, 365 negative. And I know where that leaves us, because for some of us, we're like, listen, I have to have the whole thing figured out, right? Before I can decide to be a part of it or decide to believe. I have to have the whole thing figured out. I have to know exactly what it is that's out there, exactly what's going to happen, exactly what's going to take place, or else I'm not going to follow Jesus. I have to have it all figured out beforehand. The only thing that's odd about that is, when does that ever happen for us in life? I mean, like, when do we ever start something and we have it all figured out? Do we ever have that luxury? Like, for instance, you've gotten a job, right? When you took your job, right, did you have it all figured out? Did you know exactly everything you were supposed to do? Of course you didn't. No, nobody knows that, right? You take your job and they spend hours investing training in you or giving you a mentor or putting somebody with you so you could kind of figure out what's going to take place. And then there's office culture to learn, and there's all sorts of different things of written and unwritten, and there's all this stuff that comes along with it. But you didn't have it all figured out before you took that job. That's impossible. Or even when you join the health club, right? You're like, hey, man, I was a weightlifting champ. Yeah, that's no problem. Now, what am I supposed to do with this machine? Are you kidding me? My body doesn't even twist that way. But I mean, there's things we learn. And have you ever relocated? Did you ever relocate to a different location? And did you have everything figured out about the new location you moved to? So before I moved here 8.5 years ago, I lived in Topeka, Kansas. And you know, they planned their city in Topeka. Like they have a grid. They just put a grid, you know, they just made square blocks, right? Just really simple. And, you know, and they had they had numbered streets, first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth. You know how it goes, numbered streets. And then you knew what the major, streets were that ran north and south. And you knew what northwest meant and what southwest meant and what northeast meant and what southeast meant. And I'm telling you, I could get the map of Topeka. I could set it down when we first moved there, and I could open up that map, and within an hour and a half, I pretty much could navigate the whole city. I mean, I knew everything there was to know about getting where you needed to go in Topeka in just about an hour and a half. And then I moved here. And, you know, it's not quite made the same way here. You know, there's not a straight street around here anywhere. Am I right? I mean, there's no street that goes from point A to point B. And so many times people say, hey, I need to get to the, oh, you need to get to the, just head north. I'm like, okay, I'll head north. And I get on the street and I start going north. And next thing you know, that street's going west. And I never had an option to go north. It just took off on its own someplace. And I couldn't get off of it to get where it was I needed to go. I mean, the truth is I moved here and I didn't have it all figured out. I mean, but there's only one way to figure it out, right? And that's to get on the road and to get moving. And the more I was out there and the more I was moving, the more I understood the streets, the more I learned what they did, the more I learned where they go, the more I still have a lot to learn, but I've learned a lot since then. And I think about this and Jesus' simple invitation to us, follow me. He gives us instructions on how to do that. Like in Hebrews 12, this is what the writer of Hebrews says. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. So here's what I get about this journey, right? Here's what I understand. When he says, come follow me. Well, how am I going to do that? Well, you're going to start off and you're going to keep your eyes on me because I'm the initiator of what's happening in you, and I'm the Alpha and I'm the Omega, and I'm the one who's going to develop you and grow you and teach you. And so what's going to happen is you're going to start off on this journey, and when you start off on this journey with me, you're going to realize that there's some things that hinder you on your walk with me. And as you discover that, you're going to put those aside. That's what it says here, right? Casting off everything that hinders. And then you're going to realize that there's not only some external things that can hinder you, but there's sin that can entangle you. And so there's some internal things that by the work of the Spirit, you're going to realize in yourself. And then what you're going to do is with the Spirit's help, you're going to kind of like process through that. But, you know, that's all not going to happen for you before you start. I mean, what you do is you fix your eyes on me and you go with me and you do what I do and you say what I say and as you do that, all these other things are going to come along the journey with you. Now I don't want to be dishonest or disingenuous, right? Because disingenuous, because there are rules, right? There's some commands like Matthew 28. Jesus says to his disciples, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you." But if we would even understand the core of like Jesus' commands to us, there's a great story in Luke about that. There's an expert of the law that comes to Jesus. And now, believe it, in his day, they had experts in the law, right? Because they took 10, they made 613, and so they needed experts to tell them. And the expert of the law came to Jesus, and he said to Jesus, "Hey, Jesus, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus basically said to him, "Well, you're the expert. You've been studying this. What do you think you need to do to inherit eternal life?" And so the expert answered this way in Luke 10. "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself." Okay, so you're saying 613, you've cooked it down to this. Love God with everything you have and love others with everything you have. Yes. And here's Jesus' response to him in verse 28. "You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live." So like if I'm if I'm thinking about how to explain how this journey with Jesus is supposed to work for us, I think I would relate it to like the first time I learned how to ski. Anybody here ever snow ski? Did you ever snow ski? Right? So you'll know a little bit what I'm talking about. So the first time I went snow skiing, you know, I went on a trip with a bunch of other people, and we went out to Colorado. I was living in Kansas at the time, went to the Rockies, and honestly, I knew nothing about skiing. I was a little concerned because I didn't know anything at all about it. But what happened was, you know, I ended up in a shop, and they had somebody there who knew about things, and so they fitted me for my snow boots. You've been fitted for snow boots before. You know how they work, right? They hold your, you know, they put them on, they get you the right size, and they snap them into place, and they're pretty tight, and they don't allow your ankles to move. So you end up walking like Frankenstein when you're in them, you know. But they fitted me for snow boots, and I didn't know anything about them until they showed me, and they told me, and snapped them into place. And then they asked me some questions about, you know, what my competency level was on skis, which was nothing. They asked me about my weight, different things like that. And then ultimately, they picked some skis that were fitted for me. And then they put the skis down, and they taught me how to snap my boots into those skis, right? And how to unsnap them, how to get in and how to get out of those skis. Right? They taught me about the equipment. And then the next thing they did was they sent me off to the bunny slopes, right, to learn. You know what the first thing they taught me when I was on the bunny slopes? Did you ever learn how to ski? What's the first thing they teach you? How to fall. They teach you how to fall. Now, I want you to know I was an expert at that. I mean, they didn't even have to tell them, fall, boom. It was like on command. Even before, you're getting ahead of the class. Stand back up. But they teach you how to fall first, and the next thing they teach you is what? How to get back up. They teach you how to fall, then they teach you how to get back up. And then I'm on this bunny slope, and I'm doing very well at falling and getting back up. But some of the other things they were trying to teach me, I was really struggling with. And there was one guy, Dave Van Dyke, from our group that was watching me, and he was laughing. He was having a great time watching me fail over and over and over again. So finally, I got frustrated. I unsnapped the skis from my boots, and I began my Frankenstein walk back to the lodge. And he's like, where are you going? I said, that's it. I'm done. I can't do this thing. I can't ski. I'm not going to do it. I'm out. I don't know. I'm just. And he's like, no. Stop. Come with me. You're not quitting. Come with me. I'm like, where are we going? We're going up on the mountain. What in the world are you talking about? I can't even do this bunny slope. I can't. He goes, come over here and get on the lift with me. And I get on the lift with him in some sort of crazy thing. And we're going up the lift and onto this big mountain. And then he says something to me that I didn't quite understand, but I started to get once I started to do it, was he said to me, you are never going to learn how to ski on flat ground or on a bunny slope. You need the power of the mountain to help you ski. And I'm like, oh, man. No, you don't understand. No, you need the power of the mountain. You need the movement. You need to, and you're going to get it. You're going to get it. So I get up there, and we're on this mountain, and I'm like hit the top of this thing, and he's right next to me. He said, okay, go. And I start to go, and, man, I start to gain speed. He said, okay, you know, push on your ski this way. And I push on it this way. Next thing you know, I turn. Push on it the other way. I push on it the other way. I turn. He said, snowplow. I snowplow. He said, twist and stop. I twist and stop. And I'm thinking to myself, wow, he's right. It is so much easier to ski when you have the force of the mountain behind you. As you learn to work with it and you learn that the force of the mountain moves through you and helps you stop and helps you move and helps you. And you know, this whole thing when Jesus says, come follow me, it's kind of the same analogy. Right? We need the force of following him. We need the power of his spirit and the power of activity in engaging him to help us learn even how to do this thing. And I get it because sometimes we say, I don't know everything yet. Yeah, of course you don't. That's all right. You go, but I don't even know how to use the equipment. Well, we can show you how to use the equipment. We can talk to you about the word and how to do, I mean, pray. All that's, I was like, well, what happens if I fall? Oh, well, you're going to fall and you're going to fall multiple times. But we're going to teach you how to get back up, and it's going to be okay. But what if I don't agree with everything? What if I get down this thing and I don't agree with it? Oh, that's going to happen too. That's going to happen to you. It happens to me. I've been in this thing for like 38 years, right, and actively following it. And I'm thinking to myself, yeah, there's times all the time where there's something comes up that I struggle with. And sometimes I'm surprised in a good way. And sometimes I'm surprised in a bad way. But when that happens, I'm going to pray. And I'm going to read God's word, and I'm going to get godly instruction, and I'm going to dig into myself to try to figure out why is it that I think what it is that I think. But basically, here's the deal. God gives us this simple invitation. It's like follow me. And you'll never know it all. until you're like, phew. And here's what's going to happen along the way. The Word of God is going to inform you. The Spirit of God is going to empower you. And the people of God are going to help you. And you're going to learn. And it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay when you disagree and when you agree. It's going to be okay. Because we're just going to follow Him. We're not going to get our eyes distracted over here and distracted over here. We're going to keep our eyes on the one who initiates it and the one who completes it. And if we do that, man, we're going to sail with Him. You know, this morning we have some great things to celebrate together. Because there's several folks that are being baptized this morning. Folks that have said, I want to follow Him. And they're making a public profession of their decision to follow Jesus, of receiving His grace and His mercy and their forgiveness into their lives. And so we're gonna celebrate that. You're gonna hear their testimonies, and then we're gonna baptize them. And here's even the way baptism works and the symbolism of this. So after you hear their testimonies, the pastors are going to baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And as they take them under the water, that's symbolic. As the water comes over their head, it means they're dead to sin, they're dead to self. And then as they bring themselves out, the water parts, right? And it's like resurrection to new life, to life in Christ. Symbolism, a powerful symbolism of what it means to like embrace and to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. They're going to come out like celebrating new life. And we're going to help them celebrate. And you guys are experts at this, right? Because we do this every once in a while. Where when they go down, you know, what a sacred moment. And then when they come up, we hoop and holler and scream and shout and chant and throw money. I mean, we do all sorts of stuff to celebrate. And so let's hear the testimonies that are being shared. And then let's celebrate the followers of Jesus this morning.
My name is Shanette, and I have always believed in Christ. I know that Jesus has always been present in my life. I can understand God's word, and I feel now that I want to give my life to Him. With God's presence, love, and guidance in my life, I know that I can share these feelings even more with my loving family. Deciding to be baptized is the right thing to do, and I am excited about my commitment to love and follow the Lord.
Profession of your faith. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
The first time I accepted Jesus Christ into my heart was in preschool when I went to VBS and we said a prayer. At that moment, I knew I wanted to continue my faith with God. I want to be baptized so that I can be closer with Jesus and God. I feel that God is calling my name and wants me to be more involved with the church. My family and my church have raised me to be a Christian, and I am ready to commit my life to that.
Nathan, as we've spent many years together talking about Jesus at the bus stop and at other times, it is just my privilege, and I'm so proud of you. And as your grandmother, the heritage that's moving forward in our family is so awesome. And I am so privileged and blessed to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
It's a dark fall night. There are millions of stars visible in the sky. It's chilly, and 8-year-old me in penguin pajamas feels an overwhelming sense of peace about knowing there's a God out there who created all those little lights and cared for a little me in such a big universe. Right there in the middle of our driveway, I decided I wanted to accept the grace that he offered freely and drown myself in the unconditional love my Heavenly Father had for me. Backtracking a little bit, I have always been in the church, and I've attended Fairview Village since I was adopted. My amazing parents kept me grounded in Christian principles and beliefs, and I am truly thankful for that. Since that autumn night, my belief in Christ had evolved into accepting the idea of God rather than knowing God as my Savior. I read the Bible stories and understood their meanings, but didn't comprehend the significance of them and how they affected my life. I sang the songs because I liked the tunes and the intricate instruments, instead of listening and letting the words resonate within me and grasping the power they contained. As I have grown older, I have come to realize these faults in my walk with Christ. This past summer, I attended Worldview Academy, and it opened my eyes to the discrepancies I've allowed into my life and the gap that was forming between me and God. It made me contemplate how faithful Christ is and how careless I am. I let his death, his horrendous crucifixion, become another Bible story. I had taken his mercy gift for granted, picking when I wanted it and easily throwing it in the backseat when I was finished. Yet he was always there walking beside me, shaking his head probably, but there. Today, as I stand in this tub of water, I want people to know that I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. And for it is through Christ that you and I have been saved, and through faith. And this is not from ourselves, it is the gift of God. I just ask that you, as my friends, family, and brothers and sisters in Christ, keep me accountable and sensitive to the awesomeness of our Savior, and may my life be a reflection of his love and faithfulness. Thank you, God, for the new life you have given me. Take my life and use it for your glory.
Well, I've had the honor of knowing Julia for about 3 years, and being her pastor has been a really great position to watch her quiet but strong leadership with her peers and just the example that she sets for everybody around. So it really is an honor to be standing here and baptizing Julia today. So really excited to be a part of this. Julia, do you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
And you'll follow him the rest of your life?
Yes.
And Julia, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Hi, I'm Callie Pierwitz, and believing in God helps me to know that he is always there for me. I like to put God first, always. Once I saw a baptism, and wanted to know more about it. Now I want to show everyone that I believe in God. My favorite verse is John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that whoever believes in him might not perish but have eternal life."
Well, for those of us who know Callie, we know she is just full of joy, and I am so proud of her and so excited for her. And so, Callie, because of your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I've always been a Christian, but never really felt the Holy Spirit until I turned 18. I just went through life doing things my way, never growing in my faith. I went through a dark time and realized something was still missing in me. One day, a woman had given me a book about accepting Christ into your heart. She prayed with me, and I never saw her again. I thought I knew everything I needed to, and it just sat on the bookshelf. When I finally broke down and read it, everything clicked. I knew what it meant now to repent. The verses just jumped out at me. I saw all my sins and wholeheartedly asked God for forgiveness. That's when I felt the change. I was more confident, happier, and I knew that God loved me, and now I loved him too. My dad had always tried to explain it to me as a child about matters of the heart, but I had never understood till now. The next few years, me and my family were led through many trials, but a lot of amazing things came out of it. I met my now husband, and we've been blessed with a beautiful boy. Me and my mother are now closer than we ever were before, and all the friends I had lost are now back in my life. I'm not perfect, not even close. I still struggle with things, but I know that God does love me and that I'm forgiven. I know it's time to take the next step and be baptized. I want to be an example to my family, especially my son, because he's now the biggest job I'll ever have, to raise him and lead him to God like my father did with me.
Rachel, thank you for sharing your testimony, and on the power of your profession, we baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. All right. Well, we thank the Lord for His grace and His presence in our midst. And you know, the simple invitation where He invites us to come and follow Him. So I just want to take a moment and give you an opportunity yourself to kind of make that decision, to make that choice, to say, I'm going to follow Jesus with my life. I'm going to accept His forgiveness. I'm going to accept His grace. I'm going to begin that journey and know that He'll guide and instruct and teach all along that way. But right now, just a moment of profession of your faith in Him. If you bow your heads for just a moment. Jesus, we do praise You for who You are. We thank You for Your wonderful gift. We thank You that You died on the cross for our sins, and that we confess that we are not perfect and we are sinners and that we need a Savior. And right now in this moment, Lord, we make a profession to You, to ourselves and our hearts, that we're going to follow You. And as we recognize things that hinder and things that entangle, Your Holy Spirit will work and the power of El Shaddai, the mighty mountain, the God who is our mighty mountain, will work in us. We love You, Jesus, and we trust You, and we praise You, and we thank You. In Your name, Lord, amen and amen. At this time, the ushers are making their way forward to receive the offering this morning. Let's pray together. Jesus, thank You for Your great provision and Your great help throughout all life. Receive what it is we bring. Know that it comes from hearts that absolutely know You provide all things. Receive our worship. We love You, Jesus. In Your name, amen.